2.5 billion years ago, a new geological epoch began. It was called the Proterozoic Eon, meaning earlier life in Greek. By the dawn of the new eon, cyanobacteria used up almost all ferrous iron in the oceans. Banded iron formations were deposited less intensively, and finally, free oxygen started to be released and accumulate in the water and the atmosphere. Between 2.5 and 2.4 billion years ago, the oxygen level in the atmosphere increased significantly. This drastic change in the composition of our atmosphere was named the Great Oxygenation, or Oxidation Event. While oxygen is good for us, it was deadly poison for many, if not most, microorganisms of the early Proterozoic. Quite possibly, the Great Oxidation Event was the cause of the first mass extinction on Earth. Although our planet still was a realm of microbial mats, it started looking more like the modern world. The presence of oxygen in the atmosphere led to the appearance of the protective ozone layer that blocked solar radiation. As the oceans lost all their ferrous iron, they changed their color from greenish to blue. The sky lost its outlandish reddish hues and also gained its familiar blue color. Only the moon in it looked strangely huge, as it still was much closer to Earth than it is today. But hold on, another global cataclysmic event was on its way. As the amount of oxygen was increasing, it was replacing greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that keep our planet warm. CO2 levels dropped dramatically, and methane, an even more powerful greenhouse gas that had dominated the atmosphere since the Hadean Eon, was reduced to trace levels, as it remains until today. In addition, changes in the geography of our planet also affected the climate. A large supercontinent called Kenoland formed between 2.7 and 2.4 billion years ago, and vast land masses became exposed to the air, trapping even more CO2 in the sediments. All these factors combined significantly cooled down Earth's climate in the early Proterozoic. As a result, ice sheets started to build up in the highlands and the polar regions. This led to increasing the albedo, when even more solar heat was reflected by the ice and snow back to space, and the atmosphere cooled down even further. The sun in the Proterozoic was still dimmer than today, and soon the ice built up and advanced from north and south towards the equatorial regions. This event was called the Huronian glaciation, also known as the Snowball Earth state. The glaciers advanced and retreated to some degrees, but generally, our planet became icebound for 300 million years, and life was among the factors that caused it. But how did it survive in such harsh, freezing conditions? When Earth was completely covered by ice, there were still some places where microorganisms could seek refuge. Such places were geothermal vents and fields where life could even thrive. Today, we can find them in Iceland, Antarctica, and at the bottom of the ocean floor. Some microbes could have lived in the waters of subglacial lakes, like they do today under the ice of Lake Vostok in Antarctica. Others could remain alive and well in the air bubbles that were frozen in ice. Finally, the microorganisms could have populated cryoconite holes in the ice that melted under volcanic ash and mineral dust that accumulated on the top. Today, we can spot such holes in many modern glaciers around the world. 2.1 billion years ago, the seemingly endless global ice age came to an end, and glaciers started rapidly melting. But how did Earth manage to escape this icy trap? The answer is volcanic eruptions. During the entire time while our planet was in the snowball state, Volcanoes kept pumping greenhouse gases into the atmosphere until it became warm again. This could happen only because of our planet's fortunate location in space, placed just at the right orbital distance from the Sun. If Earth were rotating around it just a bit further, volcanoes would have never been able to help, and our world would have remained frozen forever. Around 2 billion years ago, a radically new type of single-celled organisms named eukaryotes appeared on the scene. They derived from the same evolutionary branch as the much more ancient archaea, which has been mentioned earlier in the story. In contrast to bacteria and archaea, collectively called prokaryotes, eukaryotes possess a nucleus in the center of their cell with gene-carrying DNA neatly packed inside. Moreover, they had extremely important organelles called mitochondria that used oxygen to produce energy. No other organisms were able to do it before eukaryotes. The first known fossilized eukaryotes were discovered in 1.8 billion year old rocks. They belong to a mysterious group of microfossils collectively called acritarchs, which in Greek means unknown origins. Scientists believe that they were the earliest algae, or the first single-celled phytoplankton, of the Proterozoic oceans. While acritarchs were tiny organisms reaching only 0.15 millimeters, they were giants if compared to prokaryotes. Also, acritarchs were quite diverse in shape. Some were round and smooth, and others were covered with tiny spines. One interestingly looking acritarch, called Tapania, which lived 1.6 billion years ago, is believed to be related to fungi. There is another peculiar fossil of an organism that lived in oceans and remained virtually unchanged during the whole Proterozoic Eon. It was named Gripania, and it looked like a thin spiraling tube, several centimeters long. Scientists still cannot agree on what it was. Some think it was a colony or string of prokaryotic cyanobacteria, while others consider Gripania to be an early true eukaryotic alga. But one of the most enigmatic Proterozoic fossils is Discagma. It is 2.2 billion years old and predates any known eukaryote by 300 million years. The organism was quite small, 0.3 to 1.8 millimeters in size, and looked like a tiny urn with an opening at the top. Moreover, these organisms lived on land, and their bodies were connected by tiny threads, strikingly resembling modern fungi. Around 1.8 billion years ago, oxygen levels in the atmosphere remained quite low. Almost all of it was participating in the processes that destroy iron-rich granites and basalt, turning them into rusty red soil. If at that time we could look at our planet from space, we would have seen reddish continents surrounded by blue oceans and topped with a thin white layer of curly clouds. The land masses combined into a supercontinent called Columbia or Nuna. It existed from 1.82 to 1.35 billion years ago until it broke into smaller land masses that started drifting apart from each other. Between 1.8 billion and 800 million years ago, everything on Earth seemed to have been stagnating for a full billion years. Life was evolving at a painfully slow pace. The climate was stable and no known cataclysmic events occurred. Scientists named this uneventful time of stability the Boring Billion. Low oxygen levels prevented the evolution of complex organisms. Oceans were full of anoxygenic sulfur bacteria and methane-producing archaea, and on land, oxygen was used up in worldwide corroding processes. Toward the end of the Boring Billion, the oxygen levels in our planet's oceans and atmosphere started to increase. Probably it happened because the oxygen-producing life forms finally outnumbered anoxygenic and methane-producing organisms, and the land surface became almost stripped of oxygen-consuming iron. Around this time, between 1.5 and 1 billion years ago, eukaryotes split into several kingdoms, three of which are the most familiar to us. Fungi, plants, and animals. One billion years ago, the first known sexually reproducing organism appeared, a red alga named Bangiomorpha that possessed both male and female spores. It has been discovered in the Canadian Arctic and strikingly resembles Bangia, a genus of a modern-day red alga. Also, at the same time, the first multicellular life forms appear in the fossil record. In 2020, Chinese scientists discovered fossilized green seaweed named Proterozoic. This 2 millimeter tall aquatic plant might have been the ancestor of all modern land plants. At that time, the geography of our planet changed dramatically. 800 million years ago, when the boring billion was over, the land masses assembled into another supercontinent. It was named Rodinia, which derives from the Russian word Rodina and means motherland. The surrounding ocean was named Mirovia after another Russian word Mir, meaning world. Also, from around this time, we can start tracing the evolution of multicellular animals. The most accepted theory states that their ancestors were microscopic single-celled protists called coanoflagellates. They look like tiny sacs with collars and hair-like appendages called flagella. The flagellum beats and the water with food particles gets pulled through the organism's collar. Coanoflagellates often form colonies. In cooperation, they create a powerful filtering system using their flagella to increase the water flow. Eventually, different cells started performing different tasks. Some formed an outer protective layer around other cells that were responsible for feeding. This is how true metazoans or animals emerged. The very first and most primitive animals on Earth that have presumably evolved from coanoflagellates are believed to be sponges. This sponge-like animal from Namibia lived 760 million years ago and was named Otavia. These animals ranged from 0.5 millimeter to 5 millimeters in size and probably formed colonies on the seafloor, filtering water for food. They fed on bacteria and algae, sucking them through their pores into a central body cavity where the food was processed. It is fascinating to realize that all animals originated from tiny Proterozoic sponges like Otavia. As the oxygen levels rose and the Rodinia supercontinent was splitting apart, increasing chemical weathering, the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere began to drop again. The lack of greenhouse gases cooled our planet down, and 720 million years ago, Earth entered a cycle of several subsequent glaciations, not unlike the Huronian one. Possibly Earth entered the snowball state again. This ice age lasted for 85 million years, until 635 million years ago, when volcanoes once again replenished the atmosphere with greenhouse gases and the climate returned to normal. This geological period of the Proterozoic Eon is named the Cryogenian. The last 96 million years of the Proterozoic Eon, the Ediacaran period, were quite eventful and deserve their own story. Some of the most enigmatic prehistoric animals, whose nature is still puzzling modern paleontologists, appeared during this time, and we will certainly meet them in one of the upcoming episodes.